Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week we're on the Wilson River in Oregon for late winter winter steelhead with Big Dave. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television. This late winter morning we're on the Wilson River with guide Big Dave and Jarod Higginbotham from Yakima Bait Company.
All right, good morning everyone. We're getting ready to start a late season steelhead trip with my good buddy Jarod Higginbotham from Yakima Baits, and we're gonna pull some plugs and fish some jigs and some beads and some bait. We're gonna do it all today.
I am pumped, buddy. I'm pumped to be on the Wilson with Big Dave.
Yeah, we've been a year or two since we've been out over here, and we did pretty well the last time, so hopefully we can do that again. But yeah, we're gonna rig up this rod right now. All right, so we've got a nightmare jig here. And we're coming up to a bead dropper and a BnR Soft Bead.
Just gonna thread that up, put him on there.
And we'll see what happens today. I kind of have a feeling that a lot of times the bead gets hit first, but we'll see. This water's about perfect for this color of jig today, so we'll see what happens.
Well, Dave, I noticed you tied it off the back of the jig head here, and generally I tie it right off the shank of the hook, and I never had any issues, but...
Kind of the reason I tie it there is I just like that thing when it's running through to kind of be able to pull on the bottom of that and just keep that hook out straight a little bit. Seems to work.
This jig is a maxi jig we make at Yakima Bait Company. It's got the nightmare pattern, which is the pearl head, red body, and then the black hackle. And you can see we add a little bit of mirable tinsel there on the back of that thing to add a little flash to it. This is a 2X strong owner hook, so this jig is ready for these big fish we're about to catch today. So the system we got rigged up today is just a simple slip float here. And you can see I got my bobber stop bead here. My bobber stop's tied above that, and that'll run into a knot and stop the float wherever you'd like it. The corky's on top, it's just kind of a visual aid for a lot of people. So when you cast out, if you cast out and your line tends to tangle over the top like this, the corky won't sit on top of the float. So you know that when you make that cast and that corky sitting on top of the float, that all your gear's straight, so that way you don't really waste a cast. Then I come down to another bead here, which is just basically protection for my knot. And then just an inline quarter ounce weight. This is a half ounce float, so I'm using a quarter ounce weight to help me get down. And then I got the 16th ounce jig below it, so it kind of makes up the difference to help the float stand up. The leader to the jig is roughly 30 inches. And then I have a dropper down to my bead, which is roughly the same. You know, fishing the winter steelhead, I like to keep them a little longer and go a little deeper. Summer steelhead, I might shorten that those leads up a little bit.
Okay, so we got Jarod up there fishing a jig and a bead, and we're gonna set up a bobberdoggin on this, but you know, recently we've had a lot of low clear water, so I wasn't actually fishing them on the bottom. I was running a longer leader, and this is about a 7-foot leader right here, and I'd run a couple split shots on it. One just a little ways down, and then one about 12 inches above your hook. And today I'm gonna put a soft bead on this, BnR bead. This one's been a good one for me lately. It's real late in the season here, so the egg bite and the bead bite has been good. I'm just gonna slide that up. And today, where we've actually gained a little bit of water, we'll probably bobberdog a little bit, but I'm gonna go ahead and leave these long leaders on because it's still fairly clear too, so we're gonna be a little bit sneakier coming into them. So when I'm fishing them suspended, I'm not bouncing the bottom like you traditionally do bobberdogging. I usually set this somewhere a foot to 2 feet, and I'm just making up the difference with my long leader and adding the split shot. So it's fishing suspended, so we're not having that weight down there bouncing around on the fish. When it's clear like that, they're much spookier. So you wanna stay off of them a little bit and just have your rig down there and not a lot of gear bouncing around next to them. Okay, I run lots of different colors of the BnR soft beads. This one, though, has been really good for me lately. It's the molten red, good late season bead right here. Really represents that egg. It's been a good one for me. You know, in the clear water, I like the oranges, especially, you know, your translucent oranges. In the dirtier water, definitely the shinier, the pinks, things more like that stand out a little bit more. All right, buddy, you ready to hit it?
Got my throwing arm warmed up, man. I'm ready to go.
All right. Let it run right there, yep. Right.
It's gonna happen, I feel it.
There you go, right in it. Right in it. Right in it. So the water looks, you know, we've got a little bit of color actually, and this is just snow melt, but yeah, you know, it's not crystal clear, which it has been, but it doesn't look bad right now.
It's good, you're good, you got it. Straight back.
Welcome back to the Wilson River. I'm Justin Wolf. No doubt that the Wilson is one of Oregon's prettiest rivers, and nothing beats a drift boat trip for steelhead. The first few holes didn't pan out, but we're confident that we can hunt down our late winter steelhead.
All right, so we're down here, and you know, this is one of my greatest holes. I usually catch a lot of fish in here. We got Roland's fish on the plug down here, but you know, this year I've barely caught any fish out of this one. Rivers change, and the fish kind of sometimes can hold in new spots. So, you know, I'm still going to fish through everything today, but hoping to go down to some of the spots where they've been, and we'll find them down there. Is there shrimp spray sitting right there?
Oh, I got some in my pocket.
You got some in your pocket? The shrimp spray is great for the marabou, the hackle, you know, feathers, but I spray it on my plugs, and I spray it on my worms. This is just a great scent, and I've been doing very well on it this year.
We created this Roostertail Sprint, say, in conjunction with Procure. The guys helped us out get this great scent out, and it's not only great for, you know, just the rooster tail and the feathers on that, it's also applicable anywhere else you want to put it. I'm going to add it to my jig right now. A couple quick squirts, done deal. You know, very easy to apply, right back in my pocket, so when I'm bank fishing, I don't have to worry about squirting gel over my hands and wiping them all off. It works really well.
Put on the fast. And then let it, yeah, that's fine. And then if it gets too close to that one, you gotta come off a little bit, but you're probably all right. Yeah, let that run. There's no fish in this hole.
It's funny, my buddies always laugh because I'm always holding my rod up like this, fishing floats, you know? And all my buddies are short, and I still fish 10 and a half foot rods, so I'm 6'10", I can reach a little over 9 feet.
Yeah.
So this rod's almost 20 feet, you know, in the air. But I keep my line tight all the way across the river. You know, get that natural drift. That's the most important part, like float fishing, you know, and people getting bobberdogging confused with just like, you know, a regular slip float or fixed float is, you know, you don't really want it to touch the water. You want a nice even seam, and with a bobberdog, you can be a little lazier.
Looks great.
It looks really good.
It's like I was standing on a bridge. Okay, so we fished this hole for a while, threw a bunch of stuff at them. They didn't bite it, so now we're gonna run a plug through there. We're gonna put a mag lip through, and a lot of times that'll get them to go. If they're being stubborn, sometimes this will irritate them enough to get them to bite.
So your mag lip comes in various sizes, from a 2.5 to a 5.0, and those are basically just inch increments. And you know, dictating what size to use for what color water is a very important part of the fishing process. So you know, the 3.5s we figure are maybe a hair big for this water, so we're going to actually run the 3.0s, which is a little bit smaller profile, and you know, in this clearer water, I think that's going to be the ticket. Last time I was here, when I put out the 3.0s, man, they crushed them. So I'm looking forward to watch that wobble wobble whack. So the mag lip comes standard with two trebles in the front and the back, and I've switched this one out to a double split ring and a single sidewash off the back of this, just because, you know, when that fish grabs that, I like the single sidewash. For one, when you get it in the net, it's not so much to get out of the net. And for two, I seem to hook the fish a lot more right here in the corner of their mouth. Easier to release if it's a big wild one. And that way we can, you know, not damage the fish, get it back in the water quicker. You can actually see that skip bead action in the mag lip as the plug works. It's not just going like this, it's actually going like, and that's that plug actually hopping from side to side. It'll wiggle and it'll skip back over and it'll come just like this. It darts everywhere. So that erratic evasive action is kind of what triggers those fish's response to react and bite.
A little excitement. Sitting here plugging, you see that rod first initial, poof, poof, no! Then we see a little trout jump out. Crushed a 3.0 Dr. Death mag lip.
There's some pliers.
We'll calm the little guy down and get him back in the water here. There he is, all safe and sound. Pretty little fish. Time to go home.
All right, we just pulled down here, dropped the anchor, and we hooked one. And he looks upset.
He's a little mad.
He looks a little upset, Jared.
Ooh, he got a little excited.
Oh yeah, that's a good one, bud.
Yeah, he come out of the water just.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a, oh, ooh, it's a dandy. Just keep kind of milking him.
He'll eventually wear himself out. Oh, oh, he came off.
No.
Wah, wah, wah. Man, bummer.
That was a big cromer, buddy.
That was a pretty fish, dude.
Yeah, all right.
Well, so close.
Finally found something.
Broke the ice.
Yeah, no, he didn't even break it, did he? He just came unbuttoned. Came unbuttoned. Dang it.
We're on the Wilson River with Jarod Higginbotham, who's fishing with Big Dave, and we've got another winter steelhead on the bead.
All right, we just came through this, hooked another one on that same bead.
BnR Soft Bead.
Let's see if we can keep this one on this time.
I know.
Let him swim back up here. I'm gonna just keep kind of.
Let him tow you back upward.
Yeah, let him tow us up. All right, I'm gonna touch down on this bank a little bit. So we're basically in like a big swimming pool right now. So we'll just kind of see what he wants to do. It's gonna take, Cromer. Now he's awake.
Oh, I think he's tangling himself.
Yeah, that's okay. Okay, now he woke up. He was playing possum on you, buddy.
He was trying to rest for the fight.
Wow. I just might be able to go right here and you might be able to just do a little trickaroo.
So those long arms come in handy to reach around all the rod tips.
Here we go. All right. You feel him come, well, you lift on him. Oh. Yeah, surprise!
Surprise!
Sneak nice attack. Hatchery fish, bud.
Sneak attack.
Yo, good work. All right, got her untwisted there. That's a dandy, Jarod.
That's awesome, buddy. That's a cromer.
Bead got it.
Yay!
Bead got it. Good job, buddy.
Thanks, brother.
Yeah.
Dandy fish, man. Beautiful.
Okay, so, you know, as we've been going down, I've been, you know, spending a little bit of time in each hole. That last fish we hooked, I don't know if it was a native. I kind of felt like it was. It was pretty hot fish, and it was real big. This fish, nice, bright hatchery fish. So they usually travel in bunches. So we're going to actually stay and fish this for a little while. You know, if it would have been a wild fish, there are usually not as many of them together. But you find a nice chrome hatchery fish, it's worth staying and fishing for a while. Okay, coming up a little bit right there, Jarod. You're good right there. Let it run. Let it run. Go right up against that and right out the back. So, yeah, we worked that area a little bit. Nothing else happened. So we're back on the warpath here. Wind's picking up, too. Gonna get a little tougher. Ooh, that went through nice. Okay, now I'll probably just hang on to it. Prepare for the shoot. We can throw it down in front of us in a second. Yeah. Go for it.
You know, we're kind of bouncing hole to hole, fishing plugs, fishing beads, fishing corkies, fishing jigs, and seems most of the fish have come, right? As we come into the head of a hole, sit there for a second. Ooh,
ooh, ooh, it's leaping.
And, you know, they come into a hole and boom, goes crazy for a few minutes, but we haven't hit multiple fish in a hole yet.
And we've been moving on every
run.
We're
moving, I know,
man. The only time we can hook them is if we're moving.
I know.
Nice work, buddy.
In the bag.
Nice. Little hatchery fish.
Usually that's why we have 10, 12, 15 rods in the boat, man. Multiple presentations, you know, just try to figure out what they want. But today's been pretty consistent. Similar water and, you know, that one particular bead has been Doing really well. We tried the plugs, like I said, the jigs, everything else. Not to say we won't start catching them on them, but so far the consistency's come on that one bead.
All right, there we go. This is a nice one, Jarod, but we got a lot more fish to go, and I, you know, maybe we can find a bigger one for you. I wouldn't tag out on that one. We'll keep going. There it goes.
This is a kind of a mottled red color bead. You can see some of the whites actually worn off this thing, and you know, this thing's just been fishing really good. It's just kind of this general color pattern. You can see it in the sun there. It just looks like a natural egg. And that's the one they want for sure. I'm tossing a corky that's very, very similar to that, a pearlescent pearl, or a pearlescent pink color. And, you know, it just seems maybe they want this bead. I don't know if it's the iridescence, the see-through. As you can see when you get in the sun, it kind of see through the whole thing. I don't know, but that's what they want.
Hey, I hope you enjoyed today's episode from the Wilson River. Now we're gonna go back and catch some more fish, but first I wanna show you the Pro Fillet board. Now I've got this great winter steelhead here that's gonna be fantastic eating, but first I need to fillet it out, get it ready to cook. That's where the Pro Fillet comes in. Now Pro Fillet is lightweight, but very strong. You're not gonna break this thing. And one of the cool things about it is that on either end, there are these little gill hooks. So you can take your fish, the gills here, and just slide it over there. Get those in there like that, and your fish is steady. It's not going to move around while you're trying to fillet it. Really neat feature. And then also, all the Pro Fillets come with Scotty mounts. So if you see under there, I can just lift that up, and you can mount this to your boat, and you can mount it anywhere in your garage, in your backyard, wherever you might be cleaning fish, or you can just take it with you anywhere and set the board down on whatever table you have. It's really a great system. Now there's also a Pro Fillet mat. And this is something that I've really learned to like. It fits perfectly in the Pro Fillet board. And it also, because of the ridges, the way this is constructed here with the nipples, it'll hold almost 2 cups of water. So any of the liquid from the fish, blood and slime and all that stays in the mat. So it makes cleaning a fish much less messy. Now the reality is, most of us are gonna clean a fish or two in our kitchen. I do it all the time. And that is where the mat comes in really handy. I really like these things. I like it so much, I've just leave one in my kitchen. It's like a drain mat. Use it for lots of things, but it just makes cleaning a fish in a kitchen clean and easy, and definitely the way to go. Now in the kitchen is where the Pro Fillet mat really shines, because everyone knows that everyone in the house is gonna be a lot happier if you don't make a big giant mess when you're cleaning your fish. Now check this out. I mentioned that it will hold up to 2 cups of water. You betcha. Those little nipples in there just hold it where it's supposed to be. And when you're done, you just dump it all in the sink and wash it out. Now, when I first saw these, I thought, oh, maybe it's gonna be hard to clean. No, not the case at all. All that fish slime and blood and everything just washes right out of the mat. It's really simple. And the great thing about these mats too, is the way they're designed, is that the fish will not slide around. It's nice and stable, so you can just get to work. Now, let's go back to the Wilson River and catch some more winter steelhead.
All right, man, that was awesome. I told you not to kill that last one. This one might be better. This one was in some hot water in here.
That's why we released it.
Yeah, this one was in the hot water here. It might be a little better fish.
Same pattern, though, man. Drifting in the head of the hole and just thunk, disappeared.
Now you watch, I'll come back out tomorrow and it won't be the same.
No, it never is. That's part of the fun.
We'll just kind of keep letting them go upriver. Ooh. See, as soon as I said that, we'll let him keep going upriver, and he's like, yeah, right.
He's like, yeah, I heard you.
Yeah, I heard you. I'll stay down here.
Just tugging. Big Dave in the drink.
Try the rod in the river, see if it works. Just stick your tip in. I'll just see if you, oh, look at that, instantly starts reeling. Keep reeling. See you later. He's rod in the river and he's just gaining on him. There it is. Oh yeah, it's a dandy. Oh, it's a dandy. It's a dandy. It's a dandy, dandy, dandy. Big native. You wanna let's just beach it.
Wanna beach it?
Yeah, let's just beach him. Yay! Yay! There he is. Nice work. There he is.
That's awesome.
Good job, buddy.
All right, well, we pulled into this one. Got a couple casts in there, and I hooked one. It was the first time we've hooked one today when we've been anchor on anchor. It's crazy.
No fighting.
Fighting this real low, and you know, you can kind of see my bobber out there, and he's trying to swim upriver because he feels that pressure coming from behind him. If I was to get tight on him right up here, he'd just take off, but he feels that line. That line's actually behind him.
It's a good thing I am a Yeti.
Around it.
Come here, you little bugger. It's a little harder than that when you're this far down in the water.
Well, we're just, you know, we're getting kind of towards the end of our day. We're going to give it a few shots, see if we can find another one. Thank you, fish.
Thank you, fish. Bye-bye.
Yeah, well, we're having a good day.
Solid.
It's all right, you know.
Hang up. There's a fish. There's a fish. So.
You were right.
I was right. And it's been the same for me a lot in the last little bit. We get one on a bead or a bait, and then you throw a nightmare jig in, and you get one.
Well, that's what you said. You said, switch that jig, and we throw the bead through there like 20 times. And you switch the jig, goes right through the spot we just went through. Poop.
You say when.
You know, I didn't even grab on the jig. He grabbed the dropper.
He did. Look at that little bugger.
Little bugger grabbed the dropper.
Little bugger grabbed the bead.
Ooh, we got the Big Dave fist of love. Little love tap. Whoa.
Just enough to calm him down. There you go, buddy.
Thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, there would be no show. So please thank them when you can. Now, get out there and do some great fishing.